The Titanic. Even more than 100 years after its sinking, everybody still knows her story. With over 1500 deaths, it was the biggest civil maritime disaster to that date, and the sad reason why the Titanic remains the most famous ship in the world to this day. Far less well known today, however, is the fact that the Titanic had two almost identical sister ships, the Olympic and the Britannic. And although their stories ended not nearly as catastrophic, their careers were hardly less dramatic, as all of them seemed to be followed by bad luck. In the end, despite them being the biggest ships of their time, only one of them stayed in service for more than a year. Here's their story. The first and eponymous ship of the three Olympic-class ocean liners was the RMS Olympic. Her construction started in December 1908, roughly 3 months prior to the Titanic in Belfast, where later the other two ships would be built as well. During this time, the White Star Line Shipping Company was in fierce competition for the title of fastest and biggest ocean liner in the world. The latter was already held by 7 of their ships, before the Olympic would reclaim the title an 8th time from the RMS Mauritania of the Cunard Line. However, despite popular belief, the Olympic-class liners were, with 23 knots, never the fastest ships. They weren't even designed to be, as the main goal were size, luxury, and travel comfort. As a result, the blue ribbon for fastest crossing on the transatlantic run stayed with the Mauritania till 1929. The ambition to not only build the first ship over 40,000 gross register tons, but build multiple ones, was even for an established shipping company like the White Star Line a financial risk. The necessary funds for this mammoth project came in part from the American financial tycoon J.P. Morgan, one of the richest and most influential bankers of his time, who had indirectly bought the White Star Line in 1902. Still, almost nothing could be allowed to go wrong. Olympic launched on October 20th, 1910. As it was custom with the White Star Line, no christening ceremony was performed beforehand. Over the next few months, thousands of workers transformed the empty hull into a working ship. Following completion, the Olympic completed her maiden voyage from Southampton to New York on the 21st of June 1911 successfully. Her maiden voyage attracted considerable attention both from the press around the world and also the public. In New York alone, tens of thousands of people came to see the biggest ship in the world firsthand. Things seemed to be going according to plan, but it wasn't long till disaster struck. Only 3 months into her service, on September 20th, 1911, the Olympic, under the command of Captain Edward Smith, was involved in a collision with a cruiser HMS Hawk. As they passed each other in the Osborne Bay, the Hawk was sucked into the side of the Olympic, near the stern. This was likely caused by suction generated by the much bigger Olympic after she had started to turn. The Hawk's bow, which had been designed to sink ships by ramming them, teared a huge hole into the Olympic and flooded two of her watertight compartments. Despite this, she didn't sink, which only reinforced the unsinkable reputation of the Olympic-class liners. Still, after returning to Belfast, she had to be costly repaired for over 3 months. During the repair, the Titanic was still under final construction, which also delayed her completion by weeks. Who was at fault was never definitively proven, but because the Royal Navy, blaming the Olympic for the incident, gained a court verdict in its favor, the White Star Line had to cover the costs of repairing the ship themselves. This cost the company over $250,000, which was the equivalent of the forecasted profits of the first 2 years in service. An internal investigation, however, found no fault with Captain Smith's actions, so as a gesture of trust, he was again appointed to command the newest ship, the Titanic, on her maiden voyage. According to some rumors, this was to be the last trip before his retirement, and in a sense, this is what happened. He died during the sinking of the ship on the 15th of April 1912, together with the other roughly 1500 victims, 70% of everyone on board. With a cost of £1.5 million, roughly $150 million in today's money, the sinking of the Titanic was the second financial disaster for the White Star Line in only half a year. During the collision, the Olympic was around 930 kilometers southwest on her way back to England. After receiving the distress calls, they immediately set course to help, but by the time all survivors were rescued, they were still 190 kilometers away. The offer to take on the survivors was refused, as Captain Rostron, who was on the scene, feared it would cause panic amongst the survivors seeing a mirror image of the Titanic appear and telling them to board. After the Titanic disaster, Olympic underwent various safety improvements, such as the installation of a double hull, reinforced bulkheads, and 44 additional lifeboats. Similar changes were made to the RMS Britannic, the third ship of the Olympic class, which was still under construction in Belfast. Despite these improvements, the loss of the company's reputation resulted in passenger numbers falling short of expectations in the following years. As in addition to that, in 1914, with the outbreak of World War I, submarine attacks became a real danger, bookings plummeted to a minimum. By the end of the year, the White Star Line had no choice but to withdraw Olympic from commercial service. In May 1915, because of ship shortages, the Olympic was requisitioned by the Royal Navy to be used for moving troops. For that, the ship was armed with 12-pounders and 4.7-inch guns. Carrying up to 6,000 troops respectively, the Olympic then made several trooping journeys to Greece, Turkey and other Eastern Mediterranean countries. One notable event during this time was when she picked up 34 survivors from the French ship Provincia, which was sunk by a German U-boat on October 1, 1915. Because the Olympic's best defense against U-boat attacks was her speed, Captain Hayes was heavily criticized by the Admiralty for stopping and risking the ship for only 34 souls. The French, however, later awarded him the Medal of Honor. After the Gallipoli campaign was ended in 1916, Olympic was chartered by Canada to transport troops from Halifax, Nova Scotia to Britain. For that, she received a dazzle camouflage to make it harder for the enemy to judge her size and speed. Her many safe crossings in the following year made her a favorite symbol in Halifax, where even today places like Olympic Gardens and the Olympic Hall Community Center are named in her honor. But the Olympic isn't the only thing that links Halifax and the Titanic. Halifax is only 1100 kilometers west of the spot where the Titanic sank, and many of the dead bodies later found were brought there for the families to identify and bury them. That's why Halifax is the final resting place of more victims of the Titanic than any other place. 150 of the Titanic's dead are buried here. Among them is a man named Jay Dawson. Sounds familiar? Jay Dawson was the man played by Leonardo DiCaprio in 1997's Titanic. Of course, Jack Dawson was an entirely fictional character and not based on the Joseph Dawson who was buried here, who was a coal shipper on board the ship. But because his grave simply reads Jay Dawson, many people thought it was the movie character's grave. This misunderstanding made his grave the most visited of all the Titanic's victims. After the film's release, countless fathers reportedly brought their mourning daughters here, who would often leave flowers and love notes. After, in 1917, the United States entered the war, the Olympic also transported many American troops to Europe. On one of these runs, in May 1918, Captain Hayes spotted a surface German U-boat that prepared to torpedo them, but seemed to have technical difficulties. He quickly ordered to ram the submarine, which successfully sank it before it could fire. An action for which he was later awarded the DSO, a military decoration of the United Kingdom. Throughout the war, the Olympic reportedly carried up to 200,000 troops and other personnel, which restored her image and earned her the nickname Old Reliable. After the war had ended in 1918, she returned to Belfast for restoration, where she was modernized before returning to civilian service. Her youngest sister, the RMS Britannic, on the other hand, didn't make it through the war. Before her final completion, the war had already broken out, and she was requisitioned by the Royal Navy and made into a hospital ship. For that, she was repainted white with large red crosses. After completing 5 successful voyages to the Mediterranean Sea and back to the United Kingdom, transporting the sick and the wounded, Britannic struck a mine on November 21, 1916, in the Chaos Channel in Greece. Despite her having the same improved safety features that were installed on the Olympic, the Britannic began to sink, and even faster than the Titanic. In less than 1 hour, she had disappeared completely, sharing the fate of her older sister and making her the largest ship lost in the First World War. However, due to the higher water temperatures, more lifeboats available, and faster help, 1,006 of the 1,036 people on board could be saved. Most of the 30 deaths came from 2 lifeboats that launched without permission and were sucked into the emerged propellers that were still running in an attempt to beach the ship. One of the few occupants of those lifeboats that survived was a nurse named Violet Jessop, who managed to jump out of her boat just in time. What makes the story even more amazing is that she was also on board the Olympic during her collision with the HMS Hawk, and on top of that, was also one of the few survivors of the Titanic disaster. As a requisitioned ship that was in service of the Crown as it sank, the wreck of the Britannic belonged to the British government for the next 80 years, till in 1996 it was sold to the renowned British maritime historian Simon Mills for £15,000. The Olympic, on the other hand, became a popular ship after the war, carrying thousands of passengers a year on the transatlantic route, including the rich and the famous like Charlie Chaplin and Prince Edward. This, however, didn't change the fact that the Olympic class was a financial disaster for the White Star Line, of which it never recovered. The shipping company and their ships were subsequently sold multiple times, and during the Great Depression, the White Star Line eventually agreed to fuse with the Cunard Line, their main competitor, so both companies could receive some much-needed subsidies from the British government. As a result of that merger, and with a new flagship, the RMS Queen Mary, near completion, the fleet of older liners was gradually retired. But not before Olympic's bad luck returned for a last time. On the 15th of May 1934, 1 year before she was withdrawn from transatlantic service, Olympic, inbound in heavy fog, rammed the Nantucket Lightship, one of the ships that marked the path into the New York harbor, which broke it apart and sank it. The collision cost 7 of the 11 crew members of the lightship their lives. 1 year later, on the 5th of April 1935, Olympic left New York to return to Britain for the last time. Her final demolition was in 1937, 26 years after her maiden voyage, alongside the Mauritania, her biggest rival during her early career. On all her commercial voyages, the Olympic transported around 430,000 passengers on 257 round trips across the Atlantic, traveling a total of 2.8 million kilometers.